On the count of three, we're all going to wave our palms and yell out Happy Palm Sunday. Three, two, one. Happy Palm Sunday. Now, wasn't that fun? It's wonderful to see everybody here today on Palm Sunday. We do like to speak to those who are watching us on Facebook and YouTube. We want you to know that we are thrilled that you are watching us today and that we pray that today's worship service will truly be a blessing to you. And we want you to know that anything that goes on here at First Christian Church, you're welcome to be a part of it. So I'm going to go over the announcements. You'll be receiving a list of the different potential ministerial possibilities that we'll be having that you have shared. There's been an overlap of what some of the ideas are, so there's going to be a combined list coming out, and that you can look at that list and that you can pray over it. Our next Launching into the Future meeting is going to be on April 12th, and there'll be a light meal at 6:30, and then we'll have our meeting at 7 o'clock. Also, for Holy Week, we will have our Monday-Thursday worship service, and that it will be at 7 o'clock, and it will be foot washing. Now, if you're not comfortable with foot washing, that's fine, that you don't have to come forward to have your feet washed. But we hope that you'll come nonetheless, regardless of whether you're wanting to have your feet washed or not. I think it's very important that we are mindful as to what happened between Palm Sunday and Easter. And then this Friday, there's going to be a walk-in communion service, or I should say not service, but walk-in communion, where you serve yourself, and that it's going to be in the chapel. And that will be from 10 to 2 and from 5 to 8. And so I want to encourage you to participate in that as well. Also, next Sunday is the most glorious day of the year, that being Easter. And that before Easter begins, we will have a continental breakfast. That is this, pastries and other light food. And that will be from 8:45 to 10:15. And that will be in I call it conference room, or where the church board meets. This Tuesday will be the blood drive, and that will be from 11 to 3. As I repeatedly say over and over again, they can never have too much blood, because if there's ever an oversupply, then they share it to other blood banks that are in short supply. And that this is a time which we know that we are making a difference in someone's life. Also, starting April 19th, we will ask that you write out your prayer requests, that is your concerns and joys, before the time of congregational prayer, and that then I will read them out loud, and that we will pray over them. Again, this will be on April 19th that we'll start doing it, that there'll be a sheet that you can pick up if you have a prayer request or joy to share. And then also, this is important, is that on April 11th, we will have a prayer vigil. And a prayer vigil is praying for the direction of what where God wants us to go as a congregation, and that we have a sign-up list. There's a half-hour time slots, and that prayer vigil is from 9 to 6. So you can pray from home, or you can pray here at the church. And I know we've got one more announcement.
As chair of the board, I want to remind you that we will be meeting right after church to vote on a very important financial decision for our church. So please stay and help us vote. Thank you.
Are there other announcements that need to be made at this time? There are no announcements. Let us now have our prelude.
It's been a while since I've been here. I've been out of town, and some things were changed, so I had to ask Bill, am I on? The rocks will speak. Palm Sunday reminds us of the palm branches, as we waved a few minutes ago, of the palm branches on the road ahead of Jesus. Luke 19, 28 through 40, recounts Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem the week before he was crucified. Jesus rode into town on the back of a donkey, and there were crowds praising him, laying their cloaks on the road before him, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." The Pharisees in the crowd, who heard the people worshiping Jesus, admonished him. "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." The Pharisees believed it was blasphemous for the people to be worshiping Jesus because they did not recognize his deity. And Jesus replied to them, saying, "I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out." With this statement, Jesus let the Pharisees know that the people should be encouraged to praise him, not condemned for praising him. If the people wouldn't praise him, the rest of his creation would be able to fill the void of their lack of praise. All creation was made for the glory of God. Everyone and everything was created for the pleasure of the sovereign Lord. We must realize and recognize that while all of creation glorifies God, we humans are the only ones given the privilege of glorifying him by being made in his image and likeness. We ought to glorify him then nonstop. And now we come to the point of my devotion this morning. Christianity, practicing, speaking out, living up to the charge, has been declining in America and in the world for the last few decades. And what have we done? I believe we as Christians have become dormant, silent, complacent in practice and in speaking up, shouting and praising as the people did on Palm Sunday those many, many years ago. We people have stood idly by and allowed atheists, non-believers, and others to speak out, yell, if you will, change policies and practices of the Christian principles on which our country was established, instead of standing up. Are we the rocks that Jesus spoke about? We need to become active and promote the belief in Jesus and Christianity and enforce those beliefs. It's time to stop standing by silently and speak out as the people did at Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. We've heard it said, this too shall pass. Well, this too will not pass unless we become active as Christians and start speaking out. Let the rocks cry out. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, on this Sunday, Palm Sunday, we bow humbly before you in praise for all of your creation. We thank you for this great country and the freedoms you have given us, the freedom especially to worship you. As we embark on our Launch Into the Future initiative, please provide us direction where you want First Christian to go. Give us tools, give us strength, and give us wisdom to do your will, spread the good news, and promote your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We've gathered here week after week, sharing a common quest for a deeper faith and a deeper experience of the divine. I invite you now to close your eyes and let go of the things that distract and concern you. Listen. The time is drawing near. Jesus is preparing to enter Jerusalem. How will we greet him? Will we follow him all the way to the cross? The power of Jesus is that he lived what he taught, even when it led to his death. He lived with an abiding awareness of God, radiating the light of God in all he said and did. But that light was too much for the world. There are forces today, as there were in ancient Judea, that conspire to put it out. Where are we in this drama? What are we willing to risk to follow Jesus? As we extinguish this light, we acknowledge the darkness and pain of illness and disease in the world. Let us pray. Loving God, there are so many choices before us every day. Choices offered by our friends, our families, our culture, our own past. Some of them encourage the well-being of the earth, ourselves and our neighbors. Others are destructive. Help us to distinguish between them. May we learn from the choices of Jesus and embody compassion, justice, and inclusion in all we say and do. Amen.
Please stand and join us in singing two triumphal songs as you wave those palm branches high.
Thank you.
You may be seated. We come to a time of concerns and joys of the church. And are there any concerns or joys? Monica. Yes. So this, many places, particularly in the South, I think some in the Midwest, there's just been a series of damaging weather, winds and tornadoes. And I know that this area is familiar with that, that recent years, Linwood and west of here got hit badly. So let's be sure to keep these folks in our thoughts and prayers. Other concerns or joys? David.
Well, obviously, we need to be praying for the families of those people that were killed in that Christian school shooting.
Yes.
It's a tragedy. On the good news, my wife is 6 miles from the end of the trail as far as
Amen.
She and Debbie and Christopher flew out there last Monday, so they're pretty excited. They go to the big pilgrims mass at the Camino de Santiago Cathedral on Monday at noon. So that's exciting. So we're thankful for that.
That's exciting. That's very exciting. So Deb and Leanne and Christopher are just 6 miles from finishing their journey on the El Camino Santiago. Did I say that right?
Camino de Santiago.
Camino Santiago, sorry.
El Camino is
Okay. Anyway, they're about done with their pilgrimage in Spain, and that we're just we're happy for them, and we look forward to hearing their stories. Linda.
For the 9/101 troops that got killed in the helicopter crashes.
Okay. Okay. So there was a helicopter crash of some of our troops in which 9 were killed. So let's be sure to keep them in our thoughts and prayers. David.
Well, this is more for you, Bill.
Yes. Well, thank you. That's been fun. Francis.
The reason you haven't seen my smiling face for several weeks, I've been in Nebraska caring for my 85-year-old sister-in-law. She lives on a farm by herself. She had a shoulder replacement, so I was her caregiver for about 3 weeks. And so I would like prayers for her for healing. Her name is Carol Schaefer.
And what's her last name?
Schaefer.
You know that? Oh, I've heard that name before. So let's be praying for Carol Schaefer as she's recovering from her shoulder replacement surgery. Lana.
Well, speaking of women's basketball, I'm a rabid Jayhawk fan, and the women won the NIT.
There you go. Any other concerns or joys? Jean.
We celebrated our great grandson, Wilder Page's 7th birthday yesterday. And, but we do have a dire concern. Our dear friend, Dottie Mulder, is in the hospital, and we hope that she is doing better today.
Dottie Mulder? So keep Dottie Mulder in our thoughts and prayers that she's in the hospital. But also a prayer of joy that their great-grandson celebrated his 7th birthday. Any other concerns or joys? George.
The person I asked you to pray for last week, Dennis, had a major stroke. And the doctors have basically said there's nothing going to happen. They transferred him home and put him in hospice care.
So let's be praying for George's friend Dennis as he's in hospice care. We just pray that that will be a peaceful time for him.
Prayers for any traveling, maybe over the weekend, the next weekend.
Yes.
Mom will be traveling to Newport, Kentucky with my sister Rosa. It's been peaceful for now.
Okay. So praying for traveling mercies for Lori and... Oh, you're saying, but who for?
My mom.
Oh, for your mom. I'm sorry. Okay. So let's have prayers for them that they'll have a safe journey, and that will be fun. Monica.
I wanted to say that it was a fabulous celebration for Brent Brock this year. We had some fabulous speakers, and the guy from the school district 204 last Wednesday night was very good.
I had no idea what the speakers could be like, and to me, they were all A+, for me personally. And I it'd be my prayer and hope that these speakers will, maybe it's not obvious right now, but inform us as we are launching into the future as ways that God is calling us to be serving in the community. Are there other concerns or joys? Sixty-something. It's a state secret as to what the exact...
I don't remember, I'm getting old.
Well, he wasn't here then.
64. There we go.
64. Clarification. All right.
And if you call them elderly, they'll slap you.
I do want to encourage you, I know I keep saying this, but it's really important, is that we continue to be praying as to what direction God's calling us to become as a congregation. We know that the time has arrived for us to move in a different direction, but none of us are really quite sure what that means. And so I hope that you'll be involved with the Launching Into the Future process and be in constant prayer and understanding what kind of church that we're to become and what role each of us are to play in doing God's work, really to fit in with what Francis is talking about. I don't remember the exact words, but basically it's time to put up or shut up, which my mom would yell at me for saying shut up. So let us now have a few moments of silent prayer. Dear God, we are just so grateful for this opportunity to be here today for Palm Sunday. As I'll talk about in a few moments, dear God, that in some ways Palm Sunday is an illusion, because we will quickly see that after Jesus' arrival in Jerusalem, things turn for the worse before it gets better. And in many ways, that's the message that we have to be constantly reminded, is that we as your followers, we as your disciples, that we are not exempt from difficulties, from tragedies, from injustice. That, dear God, what's the beauty about being your follower is that indeed you're with us at all times, helping us through those difficult moments. knowing that even though when it doesn't seem like it's possible, that the best is yet to come, that we can be able to find peace. Dear God, there's so many things that just were mentioned in terms of the concerns and joys, such as those who are suffering from accidents, such as the troops, or those who have been affected by the recent natural disasters, or of friends and relatives and neighbors that are going through difficult times, or people's own personal difficulties. We pray for them, and we pray that we will be there for them. But also, dear God, it's important that we come here today, that we can have fun in worship service by waving the palm branches, by just having a little bit of humor, to be able to sing out and give you thanks and praise. All these things, dear God, are just as important, and maybe in some ways even more important. We pray, dear God, that we'll continue to be mindful that we do have that responsibility that was brought out in what Francis is talking about, that it's a time for us as a church to speak up into the community. It's a time for us to be present in people's lives that are struggling. I know, dear God, that if I was not a minister, I would have no idea as to the kind of struggles that people are going through. That by being a minister, I'm exposed to real hurts and real calamities that people go through. And it's very overwhelming and humbling at times, dear God. And I know, dear God, the same thing the other folks face here in this church. I'm not trying to make this exclusively about me. But that, dear God, we have an opportunity, we have a chance to share the people of the life that we can gain through the risen Jesus Christ, the life of love and grace. Help us, dear God, live by the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture this morning comes from the book of Mark, chapter 11, verse 1 through 11. It's found on page 1576 of your pew Bibles if you want to follow along there, or you can follow on the screen in front. Jesus comes to Jerusalem as king. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage in Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of the disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here shortly.' They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, 'What are you doing untying that colt?' They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who were followed shouted, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming of the kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven.' Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12.
Thank you, Francis. Deborah Paseo DeMello made the move with her husband to make a radical change in their lives. She left her mid-level management job at a bank, and her husband sold his thriving technology business that he had built from scratch. The couple and their two children then moved to Senegal in Africa to help those who were socially disadvantaged. And today, they are happier and more fulfilled than ever. In which she writes, DeMello writes, "Happily adjusted children and all of us have a worldview and experience that no money could buy." Now, I'm going to come back to this story in a few moments, so bear with me as you'll hear a little more about this story. As we look at today's Bible lesson, we need to understand the situation, the rest that Jesus had entered on what we now call Palm Sunday. Ira Brent Driggers writes that Mark depicts Jesus as a long-awaited anointed king. God was to send a Savior, a Messiah, to defeat Israel's enemies. And this king was to restore God's people and creation. Jerusalem was a royal city. It was King David who established Jerusalem as the capital of his kingdom. And it was his son, King Solomon, who established the first temple. As we heard, Jesus' arrival was triumphant. It is no surprise when Jesus arrives in Jerusalem at Passover that the public saw him as the Messiah that they had been waiting for. The cloaks, the clothes, represents a recognition of royalty. And the branches is a symbol of that this is a conquering king. Jesus was fully aware that his approach was too disruptive and offensive to those wielding power. Notice that Jesus was riding a colt, not a military war horse. He was mocking the imperial power of Rome and to symbolize the power of humility over the weakness of arrogance. John August Swanson writes that the population of Jerusalem at that time was somewhere around 50,000. And the way to think of 50,000 people is that when you combine Fort Leavenworth, Leavenworth and Lansing together, the population would be over 50,000. That week, when they had the week of Passover, which was a big time celebration, which people came from all around the Mid East and parts of Europe and Asia, that it swelled to 200,000. And so as I'm preparing for this, I'm thinking about the town that Barb and I live in being four times the size of its current population. Jesus could have entered unnoticed. The Romans had a very strong military presence during this time, during the Passover celebration. And the reason that they had this big military presence is because Passover is, the way to think about Passover is that Passover is a time in which the Israelites are remembering that they were liberated from enslavement in Egypt. And so that when you have this time of celebration, it triggers the memories of when they were liberated from enslavement. Now, maybe they were slaves to Rome in the sense like they were to Egypt, but they were certainly not free. Recalling that they could be free again produced lots of tension in the city. The Jesus movement is a movement of peasants who resides mostly in villages. He did not spend much time in large communities. Jesus will not rule from a palace. He will reign from a cross. Going back to the opening story of the family who left the United States for Africa, it was a bold move. Yet they knew something was missing in their lives. They knew that they had to make a bold move by changing their lives. And in making the move, they found the meaning that had been missing. We will sometimes hear people make announcements of moves that they're going to make, that they're going to make certain moves in their lives. That is, you know, go to college so I can get an education and go on and do great things. Or that you're a person who's middle-aged and they'll say, you know, I need to make the move of writing up a legal will, but never do. And therefore, when that person dies, it creates havoc in the family. Or that you dream of going to some exotic location, that you're going to make the move of, you know, saving up the money and going to some once-in-a-lifetime exotic location. Or that you say that you're going to make the move of learning some sort of skill or hobby, such as cooking or playing an instrument or something else. Yet nothing happens. There is talk, but nothing happens. Eventually, these folks, when they talk about how they're going to make the move but don't do it, they become like white noise. They mean well and have good intentions. Nonetheless, they don't make the move. And perhaps we have been guilty of doing the same thing, of that we're going to do something major but never make the move. I know I've been guilty of that. Jesus had forewarned that something major would happen to him. This was no secret. That is, of his death and resurrection. The disciples did not take him seriously. They ignored, rationalized, and denied the huge changes that was going to come for Jesus and them. Jesus did make the moves. He took the disciples to Jerusalem. He made the ultimate risk of all time of sacrificing his life so that we can be able to have a full life right now. The danger of Palm Sunday is to jump from the joyfulness of Palm Sunday to the exuberance of Easter, missing out on what happened between those 2 days. Now, the list I'm going to share with you is not comprehensive, but you get the idea of what happened between Palm Sunday and Easter. He goes into the temple and overturns the money changers' tables. He's in conflict with the temple authorities. Judas betrays him. There's the Last Supper, his arrest, interrogation by the high priest and Pilate. Tortured. By the high priest and Pilate, the crowd turns against him. He is sentenced to death by Pilate. He's tortured, abandoned by the disciples. And a brutal execution on a wooden cross in which nails are driven through his hands and feet. In which it closes out, in which he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? In which we hear in Matthew 27:54 and in Mark 15:34. The theme of Lent has been risk-taking, in which I have shared that there is no such thing as something being risk-free. Now, it may be a tiny, tiny percentage of risk, less than 1%, 1/1,000,000th of a percent of a risk, but there's always a certain element of risk that we must acknowledge. And so what I shared the first Sunday is how we need to be aware of harmful risk-taking and holy risk-taking. The next week, we look at holy risk-taking in our personal lives, holy risk-taking in the church for the third week, holy risk-taking and fear for the fourth week, and then last Sunday, holy risk-taking and disappointments and setbacks. I share this as First Christian commits to launching into the future. Just like Jesus, we spent time praying and conversing with each other of where God is directing First Christian. And that's important that we have that time of contemplation. But at some point, just like Jesus, we have to make the move to decide the kind of church Christ is calling us to become. And I encourage everyone in your quiet time, in your devotion time, to read the Holy Week. Just the things I mentioned a few moments ago. And that you can find this in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You don't have to read all four versions. You can just read one of the four and spend time contemplating. They are unsettling. We have heard the story so much, we forget that these are not pleasant stories. They're nasty stories as to what goes on in Jesus' life between Palm Sunday and Easter. Yet suffering, defeat, and injustice is never permanent. As you read, pay attention to how Jesus handled himself. How does Holy Week speak to your faith? How does Holy Week speak to First Christian Church as we launch into the future? Pray for us to see the guidance, the strength, and the confidence that Christ is giving to us at this very moment. We don't have to wait. That Christ is giving it to us at this moment if we seek it out, if we pay attention, that we can have that guidance, strength, and confidence. And then the blessings that we have through this guidance and strength and confidence, let us share with reckless abandon God's love in Bonner Springs so that lives are transformed by the risen and life-giving Jesus Christ. Let us now bow our heads for a word of prayer. Dear God, Palm Sunday, at least for me, is one of mixed feelings. For it is fun to bring in the palms and to wave them and to sing uplifting songs. But that we are to not ignore what goes on, of how what happens afterwards leads to the cross. And that we must pay attention to the cross if we're going to understand the resurrection. And so I pray, dear God, that this week will truly be meaningful. It will truly touch our lives, whether it's through devotions or whether we spend time reading the accounts of Holy Week, or whether it's through the Maundy Thursday service or the walk-in communion. I pray that it will truly be a profound experience, that we will experience you in ways that we never have before. For in doing so, dear God, will next Sunday be even better than we could ever imagine. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we come to this table today, we're reminded that this table is for everyone. This table is open to all who've accepted Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior. And so if you have done so, you're welcome to be a part of this important and sacred remembrance. And what we remember is the last time before Jesus met with his disciples before his arrest, in which he then took a loaf of bread. Really, I can open this. He took a loaf of bread, he broke it in half, and he blessed it, in which he says, "This represents my broken body. Whenever you eat of it, do so in memory of me." Then he lifted up a cup of wine, and he blessed it. And he says, "This cup represents the blood that's been shed for all of humankind for the forgiveness of sins. This is the covenant, this is the agreement I make, that I will be with you until the end of time."
Let us pray. Loving Heavenly Father, it's an honor and a privilege to come to your table. We come humbly, knowing it is by your grace and the sacrifice of your Son, our Savior, who gave his life for our sins, that we may have everlasting life. As we eat of this bread, let us be filled with the Holy Spirit to serve others this week and every day. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Dear Lord, we recognize this cup to represent the blood of Jesus shed to wash away our sins. I pray we accept this gift of salvation in a worthy manner and always praising and thanking you for giving it to us. I pray this through your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please pray with me. God, we present to you these offerings, a portion of what you have given us. We ask that you bless this offering to be used for your works. Amen.
Please stand and join us in singing our closing hymn, O Christ, the Way, the Truth, the Life.
Close with our final prayer, and then after the prayer we will have our congregational meeting. Let us now read this in unison, and that this prayer to be mindful of is in regards to launching into the future. God, please prepare us and align us for a fresh movement of your Holy Spirit, whatever it takes. Please have your absolute way in us. We pray expectantly in the name of Jesus. Amen. And we'll now...
Don't you just love that song? Oh, it's such a way, great way to end the Peace Be Yours. I love it. Okay, if you're planning on staying, and I hope you do, it'll be very short, I promise.